Pro TV, an easy, entertaining approach to online IT training. Access over 2,000 hours of up-to-date, high-quality video content live and on demand via Chromecast, Roku, Amazon Fire TV, Apple TV, PC, or your mobile device. IT Pro TV's premium membership grants access to all courses, transcripts, virtual machine labs, and Transcender practice exams. Corporate and group pricing are available. For a free 7-day trial and 30% off the life of your account, visit itpro.tv/securityweekly and use the code SW30. Has your network been breached? Cyber Reason can help you answer this question. Cyber Reason products hunt for threats within your network and eliminate them in real time. To Cyber Reason, real time means within seconds. Founded by former military hackers who don't play by the rules, they've built this experience into their platform. Harness ingenuity and imagination, not just code, to defeat hackers. Cyber Reason. Disrupt the adversary and let the hunt begin. NetSparker, the developers of desktop and cloud-based web application security scanners that enable you to automatically identify vulnerabilities in your web applications and web services. NetSparker scanners employ a unique and dead-accurate vulnerability scanning engine that automatically verifies vulnerabilities with their proof of concept. For more information, visit them on the web at netsparker.com or email contact@netsparker.com. Onapsys, the leading provider of solutions to protect ERP systems from cyber attacks. Customers can secure their SAP and Oracle business critical platforms from espionage, sabotage, and financial fraud risks. Visit them on the web at onapsys.com.
We're back with the security news for this evening, or whenever you happen to be listening or watching this program. Jack had to drop off. I want to say that I think I've pretty much mastered the Negroni.
Pretty damn good.
This came up pretty good.
And
I want to ask him.
Let's see it.
I used gin. I don't know if he was substituting for bourbon in some of his.
So Paul, does this mean that we just sort of don't need Jack sometimes, but we still love him?
No, his Negronis are way better than mine still, but I made one that was actually drinkable as my crowning achievement.
The bar was much, much lower.
Yes.
It's like I passed the drinkable phase. Okay, that's good.
Everyone's
that's good.
Like, the bar looks so sparse. There's not enough booze at the bar. I'm like, there's totally enough to make a cocktail. I'm like, yeah, we got everything we need to make Negroni.
You've got like 4 weeks to get that bar restocked before episode 500.
That's right. Me 4 weeks to stock the bar well enough for episode 400. Mm-hmm. 500, rather.
Because we're coming. Actually, I suspect the morning of the 9th may well be several runs to the appropriate retail outlets to, help beef things up appropriately.
Day before. I'll be there the day before. I can do the liquor run.
Excellent.
Jeff, we should talk because I'll be flying in on the 8th as well. So
nice. All right.
Yeah, Bloody Mary's in the morning. But Larry, you're not a Bloody Mary person, though.
No, but I can find someone appropriate.
You can find a morning drink. Absolutely. I mean, bourbon is just great. Morning.
Any time of day.
Doug and I were talking about dipping bacon in bourbon.
Yeah.
Oh, that's not a manly breakfast drink.
There is the bourbon. What did we have at Circle City Con a couple years ago? It was a Jack... It was a Jack Daniel bourbon, bacon-infused Jack Daniel or Jim Beam. It can be done.
I actually have bacon-infused vodka that I was going to use for Bloody Marys.
Oh, so
I've had that
good.
And didn't like it.
Didn't like it.
We'll figure something out.
I have bacon-flavored bourbon, and it's fucking awful.
Well, D-Link is actually getting sued for not securing their routers.
This is interesting, really? In that it's kind of groundbreaking, isn't it?
It is. The FTC actually on Thursday sued Taiwan in a federal court, alleging that D-Link routers and webcams left thousands of consumers at risk to hacking attacks. So just when Bruce Schneier and others were like, we need regulations, we need the federal government to do something, the FTC has stepped up and actually filed suit. Now, I find it interesting that no one else added the story. I thought you would for sure. Mm. The other story about, guess who's got a bug bounty now through Bug Crowd?
Is it D-Link?
Netgear. So I don't know if Netgear caught wind that the FTC was suing D-Link and said, crap, we should like do something about this and
Yeah, I think that is an excellent response, though, regardless of how they came upon it. I mean, why not? I mean, we've been sitting on the show saying, look, guys, come on, let's get it together. That's great. I mean, I don't know. Am I being naive, Paul? What do you think?
Well, it's very limited to a certain specific set of Netgear routers and wireless access points. It's only the latest firmware. And bug bounties go from $100,000 to $15,000.
$15,000. Right. You said $100,000 to $15,000.
$100 to $15,000. Sorry, for Netgear.
$150.
Oh, $150
is the minimum.
Yeah. It's very structured. I was glad that Netgear actually worked with Bugcrowd on this. I thought that's a great way to do it. However, it is limited. It's also limited to all of the latest firmware on Netgear routers, which is interesting. But still, I kind of was like, can I just spend the day looking at the latest Netgear firmware? Like, maybe if I find a few bugs, I can make some serious dough. But obviously, you know, there's a whole process.
What I've found, Paul, I've actually tried to engage in some of the bug bounty stuff, and I found that a lot of companies tend to put very heavy restrictions around their bug bounty programs, to the point where they're not like your typical pen test. You know, if you dig into them, you find yourself having to really work for traction, and it's a significant challenge. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. I think from a pen testing perspective, it's almost like the rules of engagement are so tight you can barely move.
I didn't see that in the Netgear. I mean, they did put all of the firmware for those devices in scope.
That's good.
And looking at the Bugcrowd stuff, it appears to me to be significantly more detailed towards their video monitoring and their video stuff. Less about their access points, but there's more about their video.
There's two Nighthawks in there, though. There are later revisions of the Nighthawks.
And the Orbi, but easily half of it is related to their wireless. But if you look out what they're paying and the payout and the expected outcomes, most of that is against their cloud infrastructure.
Yes, they put their cloud infrastructure in scope for their wireless gear, which is very interesting.
So looking at it, open redirection, SQL injection on firmware, web management, client apps, CSurf against admin interface, cross-site scripting for users on cloud infrastructure, not firmware, web manager, web apps, SQL injection on cloud infrastructure, complete customer database with name, email, address, password, and products owned, single customer payment information, all customer payment information, 16-digit credit card numbers and CVV, unauthorized access to a single Netgear customer cloud storage video, unauthorized access to a single Netgear customer live video feed, remote unauthorized access to administer another Netgear's customer router via the publicly accessible internet, unauthorized access to live video feeds on all Netgear customers, and unauthorized access to Netgear cloud storage videos files for all customers.
The other interesting thing is the FTC apparently 11 months ago settled with ASUS over its insecure routers, attackers to remotely log into them. Also, the current claim against D-Link says defendants repeatedly have failed to take reasonable software testing and remediation measures to protect their routers and IP cameras against well-known and easily preventable security software flaws, which speaks volumes to Netgear's move to open their stuff up to a bug bounty program. Either maybe they're talking to the FTC or in anticipation of the FTC coming after them for similar things like they did against ASUS and D-Link, which... I mean, all of this is not, I mean, it's not the way that you'd like it to see it panned out, but it goes to show that federal agencies putting pressure on companies is absolutely one way to make sure that we get some security in these devices.
Yep. Yeah, so I sort of see it as the stick, not the carrot, right?
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
This is the stick. It's unfortunate, like you said, Paul, that it has to happen this way or has happened this way, but either way, you know, I think we'll get there, and it is definitely a positive direction.
I got a question for probably Jeff and Larry. How often are you guys encountering these types of routers, devices? How often when you encounter them in your pen test are you doing more than Are you exploiting some sort of bug versus you're just exploiting because you've got the default password or there is no password?
Yeah, I guess I'll jump in there first. First of all, for your first question, not often. It could be just the kinds of tests that I've been doing in the last 6 months or so that I really haven't encountered these sort of small office, home office kind of devices. And I think that's largely because of the customers that I'm working with. So that really obviates the second question. That doesn't mean we haven't encountered them, though. There are tests we've encountered them. Quite often there's some first sort of level of entry is often some sort of web app vulnerability in an outward-facing management interface.
Yeah. So and
so over the ladder.
Yeah. So Joff, I will find that we're very much the same. We find very few of them now, and again, that may be just to the level of our customers. But we used to find them with some regularity in enterprise networks, and most of the time, smaller enterprise networks. But I'd argue that there were very few times, unless this was the only way in, that we were doing anything with these routers aside from saying, "What the hell are you doing using this piece of crap in here?" This is not enterprise grade gear. You need to think about something else, even if it's a small installation.
How often does gear in the enterprise? It's not home office gear, to extend Jeff's question, but how often do you find other embedded systems, or more likely than not, it's an embedded system, right? It's
right, the
ILO interface or whatever on your server or something like that, or a printer, right? Those devices are still in the enterprise, not necessarily the home. Yeah. The home gear is, but embedded, not to the
embedded,
extent.
Embedded stuff, something like ILO, we're all over that. Yeah. But, you know, something like a D-Link router or a Netgear router, either not finding them nearly as much as we used to, or if they've got that stuff in their environment, they typically have larger problems that we're trying to address as opposed to trying to exploit.
Well, despite Paul's attempt to pivot, the point I was trying to get at, and you guys kind of confirmed my suspicion, this is almost falls into our ongoing discussion of the Internet of Things as it pertains to the consumer landscape. You know, maybe it's small companies, small enterprises, small business as well, but
Not entirely, Jeff. I will say that there are small operations, small branch office kind of mom and pop outfits, to use sort of a cliche term, where we have discovered them. And the other context, and that's sort of from the external network context, the other context we have discovered these devices is the straight up rogue access point scenario.
Yeah. The other one I will say that even for some of the smaller shops that I've seen, the availability of enterprise grade or enterprise like gear that comes from some of these the more consumer focused stuff has gotten much better over the year. Like, think about some of the Ubiquiti stuff and the Orbi, and Paul, what's some of the stuff that you're using at home?
I actually use Ubiquiti at home. So
right, which is more, that stuff is more tailored to a small to medium-sized business.
In fact, I know consultants that do a lot for small businesses. And my friend Bobby is actually a huge fan of the Ubiquiti gear for small restaurants and retail places as well.
And the availability, the price, and the quality of that gear has significantly changed the landscape, I think.
And, I think we talked about this on the show before, specifically to wireless. There's a lot of the Netgear, D-Link, Linksys, Asus stuff that comes off the shelf. When you want to take a step up from that, now, like, people, I think, are missing that middle step of Ubiquiti because ease of use is not so much there in Ubiquiti stuff. But there's all these newfangled things, like the one from Google. There's the one Eero. Eero's the other one. So they're much more expensive than Ubiquiti, but claim to solve a lot of the problems and be
easy to manage,
but give you more of that enterprise kind of feel. Security wise, I'm not sure where they fall. They're kind of new to market. I'm not sure if Netgear's Aereo, whatever they're calling it, is a similar play into that.
Orbi.
I think it's interesting in the wireless market. We're seeing scenarios whereby people have just houses, consumers, that are big enough that throwing up one AP is just not going to do it. For that reason, I'm kind of a sick puppy, but I use a Cisco virtual wireless controller on my ESX server, and I just buy used Cisco APs off of eBay. But and I've got like three or four of them in the house, and got PoE. But I'm kind of a sick puppy in that respect.
Ubiquiti is pretty similar, Joff. They're all PoE devices, and they give you software to manage them. And I think that what's driven that largely is the number of devices in the home, and not just the number of devices, but the requirements that everyone wants to stream Netflix and Amazon and all this other stuff,
right,
and have Alexa devices. So now your wireless requirements at home go above and beyond that $50 AP that you had before.
Mm-hmm. That's right. One AP in the corner is just not going to do it, in the corner of, you know, your laundry room or something. It's just not enough coverage, and it's not enough, you know. So you need the intelligent handoff stuff. You need to be able to roam. And, you know, probably two or three APs in somebody's house is typically what's going to happen these days. So
it'd be interesting when they start building homes today and just building wireless right into the home. It'll be like electricity, I think. It'll just be in the home.
You know, that is an interesting point, because it's people certainly treat internet connectivity that way. And so the expectation is absolutely there.
I think the cost of running Ethernet jacks like you would run phone jacks, you probably want to skip over that entire step and just be like, well, instead of having 10 runs to all the different rooms and spots in the house, we'll just make 3 runs and bring them back to a separate point and cover it with 3 APs, and there's just a standard blueprint that, you know, a standard system that people have, and they are off to the races. So anyway, let's talk politics.
Why not?
Yay.
More politically, politically related to politics, I should say. The NSA has given more ability to share raw intelligence data. So President Obama, which I think it's interesting, is that after the Snowden leaks happened, and Jeff, you and I were talking about this, I think, last week, right? There was laws or regulations that were put into place to reduce the ability of the NSA to essentially spy on people's information in the United States. However, President Obama has changed the rules regarding the raw intelligence is how NSA shares that data with the other U.S.'s 16 other intelligence agencies.
Hmm.
Basically, most analysts that are commenting on this are pretty much what Bruce and I are saying, is that from a privacy perspective, this feels like a really bad idea to me.
Mm-hmm.
So let me ask you a philosophical question. Anybody can pipe in. We know about the type of information that's collected about us, or the typical consumer user on the internet, especially if we're using things like Facebook or, you know, various social media outlets, Google. Why are we more concerned that the government might capture certain information about us that some of us might say is somewhat innocuous, versus some of the major social media companies or you know, internet providers and so forth?
I'll take that one. So,
and I'll also have an answer to that.
Okay, so it's that whole thing with privacy. So as long as, if I'm giving you my data or I'm willingly putting that on a social media outlet, if I know who's seeing that data, how it's being used, then I can make an informed decision. I think the concern when the government gets involved is you may not know what data they're collecting, how they're collecting it, how they're using it, or who they're sharing it with. And I think that fuels some of the concern, Jeff. And certainly, I think I see your point, Jeff, is that if you're an individual, you have a Facebook account, you have a Twitter account, and you're sharing information out publicly, if a government agency like the NSA is collecting all of that public information and analyzing it, that's fine. I've made the decision to share it publicly. I've read Facebook's privacy profile and understood. But if the government or Facebook or some other third party has access to that data without my knowledge, or access to more of that data without my knowledge, maybe what I've marked as private isn't necessarily private. Then that's where the privacy concerns are coming from.
Right, and I think maybe a little bit different for me, you talk about the types of those communications, the public stuff you post to Facebook that everybody can see, and you put it on Twitter, and all of those types of things. But something like maybe my Google search terms, or a instant message conversation, a Facebook Messenger conversation between Paul and I, not being, quote, public, great. Let Facebook mine that data and then serve them ads based on that. But when it's a law enforcement agency potentially that's getting to, that becomes a little bit of a change in the scenario. Let's say I'm asking Paul for, Paul, I need a fully automatic weapon. Can you get me one? Facebook probably doesn't have a lot of duty to report that if it's via instant message. But if all of a sudden that gets turned over to the NSA or something of the like, then, well, that's a little bit different story. They're going to use that to tailor a profile against me that's a little bit different.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it ends up, you know, being about the type of data that's being accessed and used and who has a right to report and how some prosecution might happen.
So,
just a thought.
So one comment back, you know, we're not normal. We're not the typical internet user, social media user. And probably most of our listening audience is not what I would call the typical user.
Yep.
You know, let's say you're Googling automatic weapons and then all of a sudden you start seeing ads for automatic weapons. You know, there's so much information that's captured about us that most of the public doesn't really understand what's being captured about them. You know, we have some more awareness of that, and to some degree, then that gives us the responsibility, and that's why we're concerned about it, and why we advocate for or against it. But I still have this sort of fundamental philosophical issue with, and maybe it's because I worked for the DOD, but you know, I don't see a huge difference between the government capturing information about me versus all these companies out there on the internet that are capturing information about me. I don't see a whole big difference. Either it's all good or it's all bad. I live with it or I don't.
Well, the big difference is that you could be prosecuted by the federal government.
Depending on who gets it. Yeah, depending on who gets it.
Not as likely that, you know, Facebook is not a law enforcement organization, for example. And I think that's some of what's fueling it.
Right. And that was sort of my take. Again, who has mm-hmm. the information and what their responsibility to act is. Now, granted, there are certain things that Facebook and such would be required to act upon, you know, child pornography
right,
and so forth.
Right.
But other things, you know, they
but
may not.
Emails and phone calls too are separate from what you're sharing on social media,
yep.
And there should be some kind of process in our laws that Jeff could fill you in on, because I suck at that, about you know, wiretapping laws, issuing warrants and things of that nature, that mm-hmm. the government agencies have to go through a process
yep.
in order to do that. And I think there's a lot of gray area in terms of all that information that we have, like should a phone call be treated as an email, be treated as what I mark as private on Facebook? Are all those treated equally?
Mm.
Do they require the same or similar processes for a government agency to obtain those in support of an investigation?
Yeah, that's sort of a whole different can of worms to open up, Paul. You know, telecoms that are providing our mobile devices, which mm-hmm. you know, these days are not only are they and have they been doing all along capturing all your phone call information, not necessarily recording the call, but certainly
your phone records, right?
Your phone records, mm-hmm. you know, who you've called, the metadata. That's all always been captured, and that data has been there for law enforcement to gain access to
with a warrant,
you know, typically with a warrant, with
correct.
A court order. But you know, these days it's you know, and for great reasons and maybe not so great reasons, they're also tracking you most of the time because you've got GPS built into your phone.
Yep.
And you know, is our very movements part of a privacy issue? I think most of us would say yes.
Yes, and I would advocate for the same level of process that government agencies have to get a warrant to get access to the phone records. There is certainly a fairly well-established process for that. But like you're alluding to, Jeff, there's now, with technology, all these other things that are being collected about us, and where do they fall in the process? Some of them might be falling outside of the scope where they don't need a warrant. So I think it's an interesting
issue. But I guess my point is, though, you know, just in terms of mobile cell phone data, that data has always been captured by the telecom providers. So you have a certain type of organization that's capturing it, which in and of itself is a privacy issue. Whether it gets turned over to the government, you know, law enforcement or intelligence agencies that may or may not be able to prosecute you is a different level. But why are we okay with the data being captured at any level by any type of organization? You know, what, you know, all right, prosecution, that's one answer. But, you know, beyond that, what are the reasons why we worry about it with the government and why we don't worry about it with other types of companies that simply just want to get our money?
The other politically kind of related story was that President-elect Donald Trump has selected a director of Homeland Security. Did I get that right? Secretary of Homeland Security. John F. Kelly. And largely without a whole boatload of criticism and bipartisan support, which is I think relates to our field, certainly, as the Secretary of Homeland Security. Certainly we'll have interactions with our field and the general cyber drink security of the nation.
So, Paul, just for your edification, when the title is secretary, that means it's a cabinet-level position.
Okay, what does that mean, Jeff? Enlighten us.
They work in the kitchen with cabinets.
Yeah.
They work with cabinets.
Does that mean they make cabinets? What is that?
Usually they're wooden. They're made of oak, yes, cherry.
Exactly. No,
sometimes they have solid doors, sometimes glass doors. Sometimes they don't have any doors at all.
I gotcha. Yeah.
What I think Jeff really means, unless I'm mistaken, is executive branch level cabinet.
It's executive branch. It's close. You know, the cabinet is what the close advisors, the heads of all the different departments. I don't even, you know, I honestly admit I don't know how many cabinet level positions there are these days, because they seem to make them up as they go along sometimes.
Right.
You know, certainly the Department of Homeland Security didn't exist 17 years ago.
Correct.
Make sure you get that marker right. Mm. That's 2001.
Well, I could probably have said 16 years ago and been safe, because 9/11 happened in September.
And here,
in case you didn't know, Paul.
And here we got the Ferner giving us civics lessons here.
And no, wait, I had to take the
test. But Joff had to take the test. So he probably knows more than all of us about civics and government.
Yep. Well, you know what was really funny, and I'll tell the story very briefly. I did take the test in 2007, I think it was, maybe 2008. So it's been several years, but... So there's 150 questions that you have to study up on in civics to take the immigration test in the United States. And they select 10 random questions to ask you. And as a part of that test, there's an English competency measurement. I don't know what exactly that is exactly. I mean, just that you have to be able to speak English, which...
American English,
right?
Yeah.
So what was amusing to me is they chose the 10 questions. They were Mickey Mouse, you know, questions like how many members of Congress are there? How many senators are there in the Senate? If the president is killed, what's the, you know, order of succession? Those kinds of questions. And then the English competency test was given to me and by a Russian speaker who could barely speak English herself. Which I found incredibly amusing. So there it is.
But getting back to Paul's point, yes, I think the Secretary of the Department of Homeland Security is probably a position that would interest our community. So what do you have to say about it?
That's all I did was the article didn't say much else that was the appointment, and that largely there was no controversy around it, which is why we don't have much to comment on, because there hasn't been commentary on it. The media hasn't thrown rocks at it, and it has some bipartisan support according to the article, which... could be good. I don't know. Yep. Could be bad.
So I was going to say speculatively that's potentially good, right? An appointment that is bipartisan support and solidly people are behind it, then that's a good thing. Now, you know, it's good to see.
The other article that's politically charged.
Which I was just laughing about because I saw you Googling.
Googling words in here.
Googling either the meaning of or the pronunciation.
Both. Chelsea Manning.
He was Googling the pronunciation of speculative.
No, get this. Chelsea Manning is on President Barack Obama's shortlist for commutation. Commutation? Which is
go back to Google and look at the pronunciation again.
Commutation. You're good.
Commutation, which is the action or process of
commuting communist.
Commuting a judicial sentence. So, in other words, reducing his sentence, correct?
No. Or setting him free.
Yeah. Setting him free. So, relieving him of the her of the sentence.
Well, right. time served.
Gotcha.
But basically, the tradition for presidents leaving office is to
issue him a pardon.
Yeah, basically, it's a pardon. They let people out of jail that they think have paid their debt to society.
That dues.
And the president can do that for, I mean, not for
anybody.
For anyone. For anyone in the U.S., obviously, right?
The president can do what they want.
In terms of convicted people of a crime, whether federal or not, right, can pardon.
Effectively, I think you could petition the president to commute your parking tickets if you really wanted.
I gotcha. Yep, that was a good use of the word.
I understand that.
I had to see someone use it in a sentence.
I understand from my reading that the president, in the last 3 to 6 months of his tenure, gets deluged with commutation requests.
Because he's like, I'm out. Drop the mic.
Yep. Oh, you bitches free.
So Edward Snowden, your favorite person, Jeff, has on Twitter encouraged the president to commute.
Just commute, like you do when you get in your car and you go to
travel to
Chelsea Manning.
Is that right?
That is right.
So what do you know about Chelsea Manning, Paul? Who is Chelsea Manning?
Well, I think when she was Bradley Manning, is accused of leaking military secrets to WikiLeaks. For anything I can remember from that story.
Yeah, I only know because I saw a news piece on this last night.
Gotcha.
I have to weigh in on this as the token Australian as well, being that Julian Assange is Australian. I don't support what he's doing, and I think WikiLeaks is somewhat irresponsible, to be honest. So the leaks that are going there certainly are feeding a market. They're feeding a social media market. And there are a portion of it, in my opinion, is healthy. But there is a certain level of irresponsibility that I cannot support and get behind.
That's correct. And how do you put that responsibility on essentially rogue third parties that are coming in contact with information and making the decision as to whether or not that information becomes public? And
exactly.
It's up to them now, once they possess that information, whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, and what are the repercussions to that, which make it very, very scary. I agree with you, Joff. I think some of the information is beneficial to the public and beneficial to our rights and privacy or whatever, and when it becomes public. However, which of that information is very harmful to people in the field, people trying to protect this country, and things of that nature, military operations...
That's right.
That's the crux of the issue, and why a lot of us take issue with that. Is that whole process of
So putting the Australian hat on for a minute, what a lot of people don't realize is there.
Is that the one with the flap up on the one side?
Yeah, it's one with the flap up on the side.
Okay.
Yeah.
I thought it was a knife. Was it a Bowie knife? You're gonna adorn your Bowie? Now, that's a knife.
That's a knife.
Pull out my Bowie knife. Yeah. What a lot of people don't realize is Australia is somewhat of a cultural bubble. It's a beautiful place. It's isolationist in that Australia does not have to deal with many of the world problems that the Northern Hemisphere has to work with. And in that context, I think Julian Assange is, while an intelligent man, is operating in a semi-naive fashion. And by doing that, is not really, it's sensationalist in many ways, but not really taking into account the responsibility aspect. I mean, that's basically my opinion, and I think it's informed by his cultural background and his citizenship, and understandably so. I mean, I have a deep understanding of how Australia views the world, and it certainly is an isolationist view in many ways, and it's somewhat naive, and you know, unfortunately, Julian sort of falls into that that viewpoint, I think, and it disappoints me the amount of press that it's gotten.
But couldn't you say much the same thing about Snowden?
Certainly. Mm-hmm. I don't know what Snowden's cultural ethnic background is. I mean, American, obviously, but American. I don't know. Say that again, Jeff?
American,
yeah. American. But certainly he's probably been influenced by these sorts of things that drive him to reveal information that's maybe not such a smart idea. It really depends on how much you buy into, you know, who's right. Okay, it gets very deep because from a naive perspective, you know, people have to think that everything should be published. You know, and that I think that's certainly a very Australian cultural viewpoint. I wouldn't say universally. There's certainly Australian intelligence services and other people that are in the know that would not hold that viewpoint. But as a general run-of-the-mill citizen in Australia, I think that's an open society is definitely in Australia's viewpoint, and I think Julian sort of plays into that cultural facet, you know, very uniformly in line with his upbringing and his culture. But unfortunately, it does not suit the politics of the Northern Hemisphere and does not necessarily suit the politics of the United States.
Next up on the Hook, we talk about the Russians hacking the U.S. election.
I'm kidding. Well, you guys like thinking I'm like off the planet right now, but
No. You know, the news in the last day or two has been this two-page dossier that has apparently been around for months and nobody knew what to do with it. That's from supposedly, was it a former British Secret Service special spy James Bond agent that had information, and you know, was it BuzzFeed that eventually decided to publish it? But I'm thinking, well, what if it had come out over WikiLeaks? Because you know, certain people in the political realm seem to think more highly of WikiLeaks and are bashing BuzzFeed for their irresponsible. You know, this is not confirmed information, and it's become kind of a freaking mess, is what it is.
I think it opens up the question.
Dossier, a collection of documents about a particular person, event, or subject, just for those in my camp. Just kidding.
Yeah, so let me interject real quick, because I heard something there about some dossiers and so forth. But what's the difference between a garbanzo bean and a chickpea? I mean, seriously, do you know? I've never heard of garbanzo bean in my bed.
I'm pretty sure garbanzo is just Spanish for chick.
No. I've never had a garbanzo bean in my bed.
But you've had a chick
pee in your bed?
He got me with that. Did you see what he did there?
Yep. Yeah. Speaking of said dossiers,
I think everything that's happening publicly in social media right now is sort of opening up that question of whether we should depoliticize information categorization and information intelligence, and if we should continue to flatten and publish openly and transparently the things that are happening in the world, and it's certainly a question to be asked. I don't think it's a question that's going to be answered because, you know, every country on this planet has an intelligence community and has a program and have their reasons to classify information and withhold it and keep it to themselves. And those reasons are geopolitical, reasons that do matter for the safety of citizens, no matter what country you're living in.
Larry. I almost read that as celebrities, but Celebrite has been hacked.
What, you know how many times it auto-corrected to celebrity?
I you know how many times I looked at that your stories and said I wish it was celebrities, because when celebrities get hacked, it makes for great fodder for the show.
900 gigs of celebrity data.
Celebrity data would be awesome to talk about. Well, bad for celebrities.
I feel like I'm being way too serious for the show right now, so I'll stop talking.
In any case, it may end up being a lot of celebrities, because apparently a hacker, it's an ongoing investigation from Celebrite, apparently, but Celebrite had got hacked and apparently had 900 gigs of data exfilled, including all sorts of stuff about, you know, what people owned, what phones, images, emails, SMS data from captured devices, which customers were capturing from which devices. Crazy, crazy amounts of stuff. And if you think about this, like, the types of folks that use Celebrite, I can think of at least one or more law enforcement agencies that use Celebrite to start doing some of this stuff. Whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, I don't know. But
this would have been a great question for Leslie that she probably couldn't have answered.
Yeah.
Then, Larry, you had on there smart meters.
Yeah, so, of course, my browser's being completely bad. But there was a talk at, 33C3, right after Christmas in Germany, about a gentleman who basically got up on stage and said, hey, this whole thing with the smart energy and smart meters and stuff, this is really bad, because there's, oh my God, hacks against smart meters, and basically dropped, to the best of our knowledge, a whole bunch of FUD.
Interesting. I thought you were going to say O'Day, but I kind of had a feeling you were going to say FUD.
Yeah. Whole bunch of FUD. You know, one of the things that he was saying, like, oh my God, you know, people can hack into your smart meter and turn it into a bomb.
Okay, how exactly?
Exactly. And he was very adamant about it. And that, you know, this is going to be a bad thing. And from what we sort of got out of that, or I got out of that, and I have yet to watch the video, I've only taken the, quote, circumstantial evidence that he was way off base about some of the things that he was saying, you know, talking about, you know, making a meter explode by modifying the software running on the device.
Melt, maybe.
I would even argue not even melt.
Yes, because there's usually hardware, like with printers, hardware protections that prevent
hardware
it from melting.
Protections, yep. Right.
Yep.
Yep.
You know, typically faulty installation, physical installation as opposed to software. He was saying that he stated the large part of it was that he stated a lot of things that were highly inaccurate. And if there were any accuracy to it, he was completely twisting it to his own will, which was complete crap.
It was a presentation driven towards, sensationalism and gaining the microphone, so to speak.
Right. And arguably, he's getting his day in court, right? Because we're talking about this story on the show and, giving him his, quote, lip service.
All press is good press.
Yeah, all press is good press. And I think many
the metaphor
people were thinking
you're
that.
Looking for is the 15 minutes of fame.
Yes.
Now that said, in this case, all press is bad
Googling
press.
Googling metaphor.
Yep. No. Stop.
In this case, all press being, or bad press being, or all press being press, and bad press being good press, and all that type of stuff. I mean, this could potentially have ruined this guy's career.
Oh, it could. I mean, you have to be careful. Press is not always good press.
Right. I mean, tell me where the Tracer T guy is right now. I mean,
he went places, clearly.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, potentially damaging. This would not be the career path that I would choose.
So the security community, I think, in general, is kind of unforgiving in that respect.
Yes.
We demand excellence, and we expect people to produce, and if they don't, we kind of ignore them.
Hey, Joff, I got to ask. So, Luke Baggett, is that any relation to Mark or no?
Luke Baggett is certainly related to Mark, and he would be Mark's son.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, yes, sir.
And Luke works for Black Hills?
Luke has interned for us for some time and okay. does various tasks as assigned, so yes.
I was always so excited when he hears that hackers have procreated.
That's right. Yes, that's a good thing.
That's certainly the case. Luke is a very, very smart young man, and we enjoy working with him.
Yeah. And he wrote a fantastic article, which, in fact, I had a chance to read and dig into on PowerShell DNS command and control. And he created, in fact, a PowerShell module that allows you to do command and control over DNS via PowerShell, sure. Which I thought was really cool, and even extended it to some other features that mm-hmm. Are inside of PowerShell. Wrote a great post on blackhillsinfosec.com, which you can find linked to in the wiki. Joff, I don't know if you're familiar, since you work at the same organization as Luke, with this post or any of the technical details.
Yeah, well, I have not actually read the post, sadly, because I've been very heavily involved in a lot of mobile application testing lately. The fact that it exists in such detail does not surprise me at all. Luke is a really hard worker and just a really smart guy. So I'm hats off, basically. I think Luke's great. He's got a good future.
Yeah, and what I thought was interesting, too, was built into the code is the ability, and I'm not sure if this also existed in Ron Bowe's original library as well, to basically vary both the size and type of your DNS queries that allow you to avoid detection. I mean, not specifically, right. but attempts to evade detection, I'm sure. If people put their minds,
I don't remember.
Could, yeah,
I don't
do that.
Remember.
But so I thought that was really cool. It's a great post. Make
no,
sure
I think DNS. By the way, DNS is a exfiltration channel. It's command and control channel. Is really a fantastic vector. I mean, how many organizations are going to stop DNS? Let's think about that.
Zero.
But even monitor and analyzing DNS
mm-hmm.
is tricky. And you have to specifically. In various, because our software does is actually at OCM, does that statistical analysis of looking at like hosts to DNS ratios and queries of certain types or to certain servers that are greater in number than your typical DNS query has always been one way to do that. But actually to put that in an enterprise context and be able to monitor that is certainly something you have to specifically set out to do or have software that lets you do that easily.
Yeah, by the way, I wrote the prototype of that code, and what we do is we count DNS queries on a peer station basis, and so, you know, the way to look at DNS command channels is to use a heuristic statistical kind of approach where you count queries across the enterprise and you compare the peer stations to each other, and then you just do basic stats, you know, max, min, mean, median. And then if anybody has a query type that differs from two standard deviations, then they clearly are an outlier and you flag them, right? I wrote that prototype code that the guys are using, but and mine was a slow-running Python script, but, you know, their stuff is much more sophisticated, obviously. But, you know, that the heuristics is the way to look at it. You can't do it based on content anymore because it's very easy. Like, let's say you use like DNS ID and you do like some sort of Blowfish or AES symmetric encryption in the DNS ID field. There's no way you're going to spot that with the data because it's statistically flat by nature. The randomly chosen DNS ID is going to be statistically flat anyway. So, you know, it's a wash, right? So your only way you're going to look at that is the frequency of queries and look at the behavior from a statistical basis in terms of quantity and query types. And so that's kind of where we were going with that. So anyway, I'm sorry, I went on a tangent, but
no,
I had to think about it. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There might be a way to detect that, but I don't want to geek out on random minimization statistics. another time.
I thought he said random anonymization.
Paul will look at
that. That's one of my words,
dude. That was the name of a girlfriend I once had. She was random anonymization. She was awesome.
I'll just say, in a former place of employment, there was such a thing as super random, which was more random than random, was an indication that it was machine super generated or human generated rather than random.
Yeah, you're kind of talking about the orbital theories in mathematics, right? The random pseudo-random number generators have certain behaviors.
Yeah, I don't know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. Okay. Well, but enough of that. Enough said.
Enough about that.
I totally get what you're talking about.
The Shadow Brokers have essentially given away all of their malware, most of which is actually detected by most modern AV systems, which is kind of funny for a lot of reasons. One of which is, when I read this, I was like, well, what if you took some of the techniques that we talked about in our recent webcast, which I think was last week, and morphed some of these payloads? Could you bypass AV? Probably. But they did basically like drop the mic, say we're retiring, and here's all of our malware.
Well, that's really cool, by the way.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, putting the pen test I had on, it's like, wow, you just dropped out your malware. Sweet. Let's take a look.
Exactly. Right? Mm-hmm. Exactly. I'm not sure why you would do that as a group, a hacking group. I don't know. Maybe they're
moving on. Well, there might be a little bit of bureaucratic frustration there, so they're like, fuck it, we're going to put it out for the world.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I could see it.
Maybe they're fleeing the country.
Could be, yes.
Assuming they live in the U.S.
So maybe, yeah, maybe they're joining Snowden, Inc.
Wow. Snowden, Inc.
Not much else in here. Oh, no, there is one more story.
Uh-oh.
That we have to mention. The peace sign. This headline is terrible. The peace, this must come from the Register. Yes. The peace sign selfie fools menaced by fingerprint harvesting tech. So in other words, what this article is about is when I hold up the peace sign, now everyone has my fingerprint, right? Because basically, if you take a selfie with the peace sign up, your fingerprint is there, and they can blow up the picture and basically recreate your fingerprint.
Well, enhance! You can enhance. Also
probably do it with the Vulcan live long and prosper sign then,
right? Too. Or do like a wave, maybe, provided you're not moving your fingers around, like it'd be kind of hard.
So if you're doing a selfie, you should really just do the ultimate salute.
That's right.
I was about to say, I think the U.S. had it right all along. Turn it
maybe
around.
Maybe it's a new peace sign. It needs to be this way. It needs to be this way so we don't give up our fingerprints. That's what I was advocating.
That means something completely different, Paul. Google it.
This one.
The rocker, the shocker, the Spocker.
There's an old movie. It might have been from before you were born, Paul. I don't know. It was from the 80s, I think. I want to say the movie.
No, I was born in the 80s. I was born before the 80s, actually.
I want to say the movie is called Malibu Express. Somebody can Google it or IMDb it. But in it, there's a character that knows like 50 different ways to flip off people, you know, in terms of sign language, you know, based on different nationalities. It's kind of that's probably the only redeeming part of that movie. Somebody should go.
So again, being the token dual national in Australia, if you do this, you're okay, even though people can now get your fingerprints. But if you turn around and do this, that's no different than this in the U.S. So
interesting.
Former President George Bush actually went to Melbourne. I don't remember the particular date, and he did this.
Junior or senior?
That would be junior.
Gotcha.
And it was not received in a positive light.
I can't imagine why.
Yeah.
Well, now that we've talked about hand gestures and really nothing about...
Did you take that question to get the test to get citizenship or just a green card?
No, the civics test was taken to obtain citizenship.
Yeah.
The green card was purely a paperwork exercise. It was an extensive paperwork exercise, but...
How many people are in Congress?
435, I think.
We'll go with that.
That was about right. And, of course, there's 100 in the Senate. But so, yeah. Well, I mean, it was interesting to have to go through it. My kids, and this is years ago now, but my kids enjoyed it immensely because they were at that time in school where they were taking civics as well. So they got the quiz.
They were quizzing dad.
Yeah. Dad was getting it wrong.
No, dad. It's wrong.
Yeah. Okay, that was the last one that other than there's bugs in Adobe Flash.
Not new.
Really?
Not surprised. I was just like, that was more, speaking of nostalgia, like, that was more of my nostalgic, like, there's still, you know, we think about how we've talked about Adobe Flash bugs since episode 1 or 2, and here we are in episode 496, and there's still remotely exploitable bugs in Adobe Flash.
Yeah, 496. Yeah.
Wow. Outstanding.
That's also the number of bugs in Flash per year on average.
Yeah, 400 Oak Street. Yeah, I drive my car in the driveway on Sundays. Yeah,
so, 496. I think any of us that give InfoSec presentations should just start opening up with the line, Adobe, the gift that keeps on giving.
It does.
Every time.
In the Microsoft Edge browser, which is just atrocious to use. I don't know how anyone uses that browser, to be honest.
Yeah, well, they do. They use it to download Chrome or Firefox.
Mm-hmm. That's about what I use it for. apparently, Flash content now will be click to load, because that's going to stop people from loading Flash content.
Yeah, I can't even say that. Why
is this not loading? Click. Oh, hey, look, there it is.
Hey, look, I'm pwned. It's great.
Don't click shit, but you have to click shit.
To watch the cat video or whatever. We were talking about those ridiculous videos where people like wrap up an avocado and give it to their kid for Christmas and they start crying, which I just think is just so wrong. It's so
mean. I mean, let's face it. People are going to either browse kittens on the internet or look at Trump tweets, and that's really going to be about it. So
click to load. Click to load.
I kind of wish we'd all refuse to look at Trump tweets, but that's just me.
Wow. I think we just went...
I think we all know what most people look at on the internet, and it's definitely
and
not...
And it's not Trump tweets.
It's related to kittens.
It may be Melania Trump, but that's a different story altogether.
Oh, wow.
Ooh, Ivanka. Ivanka.
That too.
Oh, boy. Well, that concludes this edition of Paul Security Weekly. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in. Larry, take us out.
Over and out.